Beneath the ice of one of North America's largest lakes lurks a prehistoric beast. A half century of conservation has brought these beasts back from the brink of extinction to unprecedented numbers and unimaginable size.
We don't really know how big these fish will get for sure.
They appear and disappear like ghosts.
I've been waiting for a fish for 14 years.
The pursuit of these mysterious monsters lures men to risk their lives. They are called the Frozen Chosen. Armed not with hook and line, but 7-foot spears, these brave hunters fight sub-zero conditions and treacherous ice.
I never feel 100% safe out there. I never will.
Those that persevere.
Right there. You see it?
See him?
And are quick to throw their spear can become a legend of the ice. Meet the Frozen Chosen, battling life-threatening conditions and coming face-to-face with a monster. Like the closing of a cold steel trap, the Wisconsin winter grips Lake Winnebago's entire 140 square miles and freezes it into an endless sheet of ice.
We'll see what happens with the snowstorm and hopefully.
Arctic winds blow with near hurricane force, and temperatures dip so low a can of beer will freeze solid in a matter of minutes.
Yeah, it is survival. It's the adventure, you know, to be so cold.
For 16 days each winter, a rare breed of sportsmen known as the Frozen Chosen battle the elements and a mythical beast. Families like the Mookies, Dad, son Chad, and his brother Stuart arm themselves with 7-foot spears.
Most of those people that do not get involved in this probably think we're absolutely crazy, which they might be onto something there.
In addition to spears, their arsenals include giant chainsaws with massive blades to cut through ice up to 3 feet thick. They carve a hole about the size of a big screen TV. To protect themselves from the sub-zero winds, they haul shanties out onto the ice. Once inside, they keep their spears close, eyes on the hole, and wait to see the shadow of a monster.
And the largest one yesterday was registered at Wentz on the lake.
If you're gonna go out on a frozen lake and hunt with a spear, it better be for something big. The Frozen Chosen are after one of the largest, oldest, and ugliest fish you'll ever see. The giant lake sturgeon.
Nobody really knows just how big these fish can get.
Ron Brook is the foremost authority on these fish. He says that beneath the ice are sturgeon a century old, over 7 feet long, and could tip the scale at 300 pounds.
Every population has been overexploited at one time or another since the middle of the 1800s. And they really haven't had an opportunity anywhere until now on the Winnebago system to show us their true potential for longevity and growth.
Lake sturgeon have been around since the days of the dinosaurs. Lake Winnebago and its tributaries hold the largest population of these prehistoric beasts in the world. As a result, men, women, families, and even entire towns are obsessed with spearing.
And you want to get your tickets for the 50th Sturgeon Awards banquet.
Local DJ Jerry Schneider even has a radio show with a mix of sturgeon reports and polka music.
And by the way, Karen's got a couple of sturgeon in here that were just called in, so there's a little action out there. It's the Jerry Volker Band, another springtime polka.
It is a sporting spectacle found nowhere else on the planet. But another Mookie brother explains there's a catch.
It's not a sport for everybody. I mean, the danger definitely exists. There are chances you take.
The fact is, people die doing this. Sturgeon spearing is a high reward, high risk sport. First, you must drive several miles out onto the unstable ice, where cracks extend in every direction.
Cracks can form and they change so much that they actually put small bridges out there. Trucks are actually going over the cracks, over open water, from one piece of ice to the other.
If you've passed the test for bravery and are still on the ice, this sport will now test your patience.
You gotta have a lot of patience. Sit there day after day, hour after hour, day after day, 16 days straight.
Winnebago is a huge lake, and you're looking down a small hole. The odds are a lot like the weather. Miserable.
It's like duck hunting through a chimney. Yeah, you wait that long.
Sturgeon spearing could be defined as an odd combination of intense concentration and blind luck.
When it gets right down to it, the point of contact is that hand-thrown spear into that fish and having the patience to sit and wait for some people 10 minutes, some people 10 years.
We used to travel from here clear down here with the boat. There's a good spot right out here.
No one has spent more days spearing than Al Schumacher. At age 94, he is the lake's elder statesman.
I don't know if anybody else is older than I out there fishing. I don't.
He's speared more sturgeon than he's got children, grandchildren, or great-grandchildren. Which is saying a lot, since there are now so many Schumachers, they claim a couple acres of ice for their own spearing village.
When we had this bunch of kids, I'd take them along out to the lake fishing with me to get them out of the house, get them out of my wife's hair.
Wisconsin winters are long, and this is a barren land. You can either head out on the ice and risk your life for a sturgeon, or sit inside, look out the window, and wait for spring. You're gonna wait either way. Now, for Al's grandson, Kevin, the wait is getting out of hand. His patience has been tested for half his life.
I've been waiting for a fish for 14 years.
So why would someone stare down a hole in the ice and wait that long for a fish? Sturgeon eggs are used to make tasty caviar, and the delicate flesh is also delicious. However, this sport is less about putting food on the table and more about bragging rights.
70.2. Where's the green tag for this?
The man in the festive fishing hat is Kendall Comkey, fisheries biologist for the state of Wisconsin. His sharp pencil records the size of every sturgeon speared on this part of the lake, while his sharp eye measures up the people that bring them in. As he sees it, the frozen chosen have a goal and a wish. The goal is to spear a sturgeon, and the wish is that your fish is bigger than the next guy's.
You're elevated and walking around, you know, a little taller and a little spring in your step for that year, because there's a lot of people that didn't get a fish. There's also a lot of shame when you come in with a really little one.
It's a fact. Size does matter.
A fish is a fish, but it's always nice to have yours a little bit bigger than everybody else's.
No species of fish on the continent is bigger, older, or more fascinating than the sturgeon. From the first time man caught a glimpse of a giant sturgeon, it became the stuff of legend. Native American lore is filled with tales of mysterious giants of the deep. The beasts were revered for their size and hunted for their flesh. The first tool used to slay a lake sturgeon was likely some type of spear. In winter, many tribes' very survival depended on sturgeon for food. Out of necessity, they perfected the process of spearing through the ice.
The Native Americans basically taught the early settlers, you know, that this was a food source and how to do it with the old lay on the ice on the buffalo robes, put another one over your head, and then look down the hole, and they had the little carved fish decoy as an attractant, or a coaxer, as they call it.
The buffalo robes have been replaced by shanties, but the spears remain.
The spears that are out there are all made by people that have either speared or
family members that passed it on that used to spear.
You won't find a sturgeon spear at your local sporting goods store. They're built in barns, garages, and workshops one at a time.
It takes a long time to build a spear.
Al Schumacher should know. He's been making and selling spears longer than, well, anybody. After 8 decades of cutting, grinding, and drilling out parts, Al's handed the heavy lifting of spear making over to his son, Donnie, but still serves as a consultant.
He's been doing this since the Great Depression, and it just keeps going on. I mean, it's gonna be a family tradition for years.
You've got stuff that's handed down from grandpa to son to grandson.
Well, we kept our chisels sharp that time because we didn't, that's where we cut our holes.
It isn't just equipment that gets passed down. Al takes every opportunity to sprinkle the family tree with spearing knowledge. Grandson Kevin soaks up every drop.
They basically make a circle.
Yeah, they follow right around.
On the day before the opening of every spearing season, 4 generations of sturgeon spearing Schumachers gather for breakfast. You see, Al and his wife had 12 kids who grew up and had kids, and their kids had kids, and they all learned how to spear.
I've been going on a lake since I was basically born, you know, I mean, we were out on that lake as soon as we could walk.
After breakfast, Al gathers the troops and deploys a fleet of vehicles to the lake. The Schumachers don't just arrive on the ice, they invade. Like a conquering army, they claim their territory, and the old general directs the attack.
Should he bring the other one over here, or lead them two over there?
Yeah, tell you what, you only need one spear.
Yep.
A platoon of Schumachers swiftly show their mettle with chainsaws and chisels. This is an essential but potentially dangerous ritual called cutting in. The ice is 1.5 feet thick. Sawing, stomping, and pushing with poles, the men will open 18 holes, one for each Schumacher shanty.
It's just unbelievable. Just unbelievable to have a whole crew like that to go and stay together and go fishing.
If the Schumachers are an army, the Mookies are the Navy SEALs of spearing. Their dedication, ingenuity, and expertise have earned them a reputation on the ice.
The Mookies are probably one of the best spearing families on the lake, I would say. They do all the right stuff. They know exactly where to go. They're not tied into any particular spot in the lake. They go wherever they have to go to find the best conditions, the best food, the best concentration of fish. And I really don't know what all their secrets are, but they certainly know how to do it, and they are very successful.
At dawn, with the mercury buried at 10 below zero, the Mookies show their quick strike capabilities. They unload small shanties and travel by snowmobile rather than icy roads clogged with cars.
Just follow the path, my path. Just make it wide enough, more than wide enough for the shanties, so we get some compaction on that snow.
Stuart Mookie could be described as MacGyver on ice. His inventiveness and spearing savvy set him apart from his peers.
There's a lot of ways to put the pieces of the puzzle together, and I enjoy that. And usually we put ourselves in a position to win.
It's as if the Mookies have stealth shanties. Even though the family is famous for finding fish, there isn't another shanty as far as the eye can see. A tactician with a chainsaw, Stuart cuts in a hole of perfect proportions. Water quality is another key to spearing success. If you can see the bottom, you can see the fish.
Look at that dead shed. That's clear water.
That's on bottom.
Yes, sir. All right.
Stewart's father and brother will soon join him on the ice for what looks to be a promising season.
Does it get any better than that? It doesn't. You know, my dad, my brothers, my children.
Back over in Schumacherville, they feel the same way. Nothing brings families together like sturgeon spearing.
We've had seasons where nobody's gotten a fish, or we've only gotten like one or two fish. You know, it's not all about that fish. It's about being out there with the family and being happy for everyone.
Sturgeon spearing has it all. Family tradition, a cast of characters, mythical monsters, and music.
Here's the Bernie Roberts Band, the Cool City Polka.
For as long as folks can remember, Jerry Schneider has been spinning the soundtrack for the spearing season.
Right now we're going to do the sturgeon spearing report for this Saturday.
When you can hear polka music and hear a fishing, a sturgeon report every 15 to 20 minutes, then you know you're near Lake Winnebago.
Here's how it works. When you spear a sturgeon, you call into the station.
Good morning, Jerry Schneider Show. You've got one. Is it very big?
Jerry's wife, Karen, takes down the size of the fish and the general location it was speared in.
At Stockbridge Harbor. Okay, thank you very much for calling.
She hands the note to Jerry, and instantly fame and fortune are yours.
We do have a sturgeon to report here. Chris Halbach of St. Cloud got a 58-inch, 53-pound sturgeon.
You get $10 in cash from Lakeshore Septic Service.
Now, most people probably don't listen to much polka at home, but Jerry says inside these shanties, his ratings are through the roof.
Ran into a fellow, he had his little son along, and he was maybe 4 years old, 5 years old at the time, and he got the shanty all ready to go for a sturgeon spearing that day, and all of a sudden the little boy looked up at him and he said, "Say, Dad, when are we going to turn that sturgeon fishing music on?" That came from a little fella.
Jerry's captured the essence of the sport. The attraction of big fish, tradition, and having a good time.
He's got the whole vernacular, he's got the whole accent. I mean, it's the whole package, it really is. You know, and it's a part of the sturgeon culture that is just priceless.
Okay, that takes care of the sturgeon report for this Saturday morning. Sturgeon spearing on Lake Winnebago in the upriver lakes. It's just so much fun.
The existence of the sturgeon can be traced to the dawn of time. This young sturgeon from Lake Winnebago has the same anatomy as his ancestors that swam with dinosaurs. There's something about prehistoric prey that brings out the inner caveman in the frozen chosen. As they see it, you can't hunt for a dinosaur, but you can throw a spear at a sturgeon.
You just threw that spear at a prehistoric fish, and then, you know, how big is he? You know, is it the big one that everybody dreams about?
It's an ancient fish. It's a sturgeon. More half the time, the ones that you see are older than you.
Each time a sturgeon is speared, it's an opportunity to get face to face with one of the oldest and ugliest fish on Earth.
It is such a large animal, and it's prehistoric. Has this kind of this mysterious feel about it.
Your average sturgeon is about the size of a torpedo with rows of armor plates on its back and a shark-like tail. But unlike sharks, sturgeon don't have teeth. Most people have never seen anything like it.
Their bottom feeder and the mouth makes them look so different than any other fish. The mouth is on the bottom of the fish. When they're feeding, they just go along the bottom and suck it in. It's like a vacuum cleaner.
For millions of years, these unique beasts were the ultimate survivors. However, at the hands of man, they barely escaped extinction in the 19th and 20th centuries.
In the Great Lakes, sturgeon were at one time viewed as a nuisance because they would tangle up in the nets of the fishermen. And so they'd bring them in and they'd stack them on shore. It looked like rotting cordwood.
The nuisance label on Lake Sturgeon would soon be removed with the caviar craze of the late 1800s. Sturgeon populations in Russia and Eastern Europe collapsed under the weight of demand. The caviar kingpins came to North America and unleashed an unimaginable slaughter. Commercial fishermen on the East Coast and Great Lakes harvested sturgeon by the millions, and small-time poachers took care of the rest.
What they were doing, they were taking these fish, netting them, and taking the spawn and selling it for caviar. And the rest of the fish they'd dump.
By 1915, there weren't enough fish left in the U.S. to export. With the great fish on the brink of extinction, the state of Wisconsin took action. A law was passed making it illegal to take a sturgeon by any means.
We had spearing up until 1915, and then the sturgeon harvest was banned statewide at that time until 1932. And then in 32, the first modern-day spearing season was opened on Winnebago. It was actually part of a stimulus bill during the Depression passed by the Wisconsin State Legislature. Give people fish to eat because they needed the food.
The new sturgeon spearing season also ushered in an era of research, management, and public education. The Wolf River is one of several tributaries for Lake Winnebago. For the past 50 years, wildlife managers and biologists have visited the spectacular spring spawning run on the Wolf.
The spring of the year is really a magic time for Lake Sturgeon anywhere, but especially here on the Winnebago system. And we have probably somewhere in the neighborhood of 20,000 sturgeon.
I'll pick it up a little bit, slide forward, and I'll take it. Got a bite.
Ron Brook oversees a capture and release operation at various sites along the river. At times, the water boils with spawning sturgeon.
It's one of the few places in the world where you can literally get within inches of a 150 or 200 pound spawning lake sturgeon right at your feet.
Once the beast is netted, it's carried to a crew who document the sex of the fish and do their best to get a measurement. This is science conducted in the midst of a wrestling match.
It's just amazing where we will have, you know, two or three guys on the measuring board because these things are extremely powerful animals and they're not too happy that they're out of water and we're trying to measure them.
Bring it a prayer. You already got 14 on the ground.
Wow, he's ripped.
Come here, buddy, we'll get you out of here.
63.3.
67.7.
57.8.
After the examination, the sturgeon gets a slip and slide ride back to the river. Ron Brook and Kendall Comke have given the bulk of their professional lives to what is recognized as one of the great wildlife management stories of the last half century.
Lake Winnebago, we like to boast that it's the largest population of this particular species in North America. And it's in as good a shape as we have in written history.
When you have a story and a spectacle this good, it's going to draw a crowd.
I think the reason it attracts so many people is because you have this prehistoric 4 to 5.5 foot fish right along the shoreline. Their backs and their tails and their fins are sticking out of the water while they're going through this ancient ritual of spawning and laying those eggs amongst those rocks. And it's just something that you're not going to see in a lot of places.
Why are you laughing?
It's a fantastic show, but it only plays for a limited engagement. Females release their eggs over an 8 to 12 hour period. Exhausted, they disappear into the depths and let the current of the river carry them back to the lake. Like any good fish story, those that saw this spawning run say the sturgeon were larger than last year.
There's some 200 pounders and then some, 230, 240 probably. 250, possibly.
I definitely could believe that there's a 300-pounder out there.
Talk of lake sturgeon reaching 300 pounds has circulated in these parts for years, but mostly by tellers of tall tales in the taverns. Not anymore. Kendall Gomke's crew recently netted a massive female, estimated to be 125 years old. Half her eggs were gone, and she still weighed over 240 pounds. For the frozen chosen, sturgeon spearing is a highlight of the year, right up there with deer hunting, the Daytona 500, and the Super Bowl.
It's like a holiday. I've always considered sturgeon spearing the Super Bowl of fishing by far.
Add to that the prospect of spearing a 300-pounder, and now you're talking about maybe the highlight of your life.
It's not out of the possibility of spearing one in the near future that could go 300 pounds, and it's just, it's staggering. It's just, it's awesome. It's great to be living in this moment.
On the eve of the sturgeon spearing season, the frozen chosen don't get much sleep. It's a case of adrenaline-induced insomnia.
Just the excitement to get out there. It's a thrill. That's what it is. You look forward to it.
It's the Super Bowl. It's Christmas. It's the 4th of July. It's everything in February.
Under the cover of darkness, the Mokis slip away on snowmobiles to their secret spearing sites.
Nothing has ever given me the feeling like that morning when you're out on the ice and just before sunrise, and it's just a quiet, calm morning.
And you go out there and seeing the sun rise and seeing that come up and just being out on the bare ice, looking, hoping for that sturgeon, it's awesome.
See, that's what holds it on, just a rubber band, so.
At first light, Don Mokey prepares to do battle with the beast. As spearers go, Don is an expert marksman. Legend has it he's missed only once in 40 years.
If I had to make a statue of a sturgeon spear, I would definitely form it like him, because that man will not move. He will just sit there and he will look in the hole. If there was a million-dollar fish out there and I had to pick one person to get it, it would be my father. He's stone cold.
The season begins at sunrise and lasts for 6 hours each day.
Just get in there and get things ready, your decoy down. Make sure that the spear's where it belongs, everything's together.
There's a cap on the number of fish that can be speared each year. The season runs for 16 days, or until the cap is reached, whichever comes first. Each spearer is allowed to take one fish. The season was just minutes old when Don's spear pierced the skin of a sturgeon. It's a bittersweet kill. He's happy to have speared a fish, but disappointed it isn't a big one.
That's one thing I didn't want, is get one this size.
Don's frustration fades as he knows he's in elite company.
You got your fish, and it's a prize. It definitely is, you know, and nobody else in the world is getting them besides the people that are right there.
The odds of spearing a sturgeon any size are incredibly low. Some years, nearly 90% of spearers leave the ice without a fish. Some wait days for a fish. Some wait weeks. Others wait for years.
Just staring at blink water, staring at two decoys all day. I've been waiting for a fish for 14 years.
A guy speared a fish and came in, and I think he told me he had looked down the hole for 23 years. That was the first fish he ever saw that he speared. And I don't know how you could possibly do that, how you could hold your concentration and an interest in something that long.
Patience, for one. Patience is the biggest thing.
They say patience is a virtue, but sometimes it's great to just be lucky.
There's no trick to it. You just, you got to be there when the fish is there, and if you're lucky, you're lucky.
Chad Mookie apparently feels so lucky. He's willing to let a huge sturgeon swim right by because he's certain Lady Luck will bring him a bigger one.
It's big, but it's not big enough, buddy. Ladies and gentlemen, I might be the craziest person in the world.
Oh, man, maybe I should have taken him. And you know, sturgeon spearing, you might not never see a fish for the rest of the year. You might wish you would have done it, but it takes discipline to pass them up. But, you know, that's what's fun about it, second-guessing yourself and not knowing.
Chad's brother Paul doesn't even have to see a fish to get excited. Just thinking about a monster beneath his feet is all it takes.
It's knowing something is there and not seeing it. It's just kind of like the movie Jaws, you know, it's coming up, you know it exists, but you don't see it.
Most guys aren't like Paul. The endless void and the silence near shanty can become unbearable. You either turn on Jerry Schneider's show and listen to spearing success stories.
Paul in 69.4 inches.
Or you start to make up a story of your own.
You spend 6 hours in a enclosed room, you come up with some pretty good stuff, whether it's true or not.
You know, the most famous one is about the guy fishing with his black lab. And the lab sees a fish in the hole and gets excited and jumps in the hole.
The dog actually, whether he fell or jumped into a hole, and disappeared.
The dog is gone.
And gets caught under the ice.
You know, that dog may swim 50, 60, 100 yards.
All of a sudden, here the dog is. It swam underneath the ice, comes up in another guy's hole.
And scares the spear so bad when he comes out of that hole that he goes right through the side of the shack.
Shanties sit that close together that it's a very probable story.
I don't believe it. I don't believe that ever happened.
Paul Mookie was telling a similar tale to a couple of buddies when a true spearing story unfolded.
Right there. You see it?
See him down
below.
You see
it? I gotta get the spear off. Take your time, lower it down. Lower. Okay, you got it.
I'll take it down.
Water. Everything goes through your mind after you've been sitting there for hours, days, weeks, months, sometimes years. You know, all of a sudden it all comes together so fast, and it's intense.
All right. Woo!
Big player, drag him.
Nice.
Fish on the ice.
Good luck in fishing.
On the ice.
All right.
You've just slain a prehistoric beast. Now it's time to head to shore and revel in the glory. The weigh-ins take on a carnival atmosphere. The successful spearers become instant celebrities.
It goes like this, you're either a hero or you're a zero.
Huge crowds gather to guess the weight of the fish.
Everybody takes their guesses, you know, what they think that fish will weigh and the actual weight comes in, and everybody waits for that final weigh-in.
70 right now.
Oh, 87.
Close on that one.
When a fish comes in, we gather the basic biological data as well as legally register that fish for that spirit.
57.9 inches.
An incision is cut into the underbelly to identify the sex and age of the sturgeon.
See yep. All those little tiny yellow yep. Eggs in there?
Yep.
All right. That's not fat right there, that's the ovary, okay?
In this part of the world, this is the sporting and social event of the season. Sturgeon spearing isn't just for the men in the family.
We got her.
A growing number of women are proving to be lethal with a spear.
It's kind of a bloodbath. A little chaotic, a little barbaric, but nobody seems to mind.
Some folks will cook and eat their catch. Others celebrate by dining out amidst the carnage.
They're eating right here, and right through the window, the fish are hanging right there as they're eating their dinner. But yeah, it is pretty unique.
It's kind of one of the grossest things in the world, but people accept it and like looking at them while they're eating. It's pretty cool.
Back out on the ice, Al Schumacher is splitting time between scanning for sturgeon.
I just wonder if I'll see one this year.
And spinning yarns from days of yore.
In the morning, there was one about 40 pounds, come right through. Jesus Christ. I put my hand over, I could see that shadow moving, I thought it was a fish.
Chad Mookie is still watching big sturgeon swim right by while he waits for a record.
Look at that, I was just sitting there. Jeez. Could end my season right now, but I'm not gonna.
Chad's luck may be running out. Generous Jerry is running out of prizes.
What have we got left here? A $20 gift certificate?
Jerry's prize shortage is a sign that spears are finding fish. If the DNR's fish cap is reached, the season may end before Chad ever throws his spear. But he may have a bigger problem. Outside, a warm wind is blowing across the ice. As the mercury rises, so does the level of danger. The endless ice and snow of Lake Winnebago looks like the perfect winter wonderland. But it is also a dangerous giant that can swallow men and machines and send them to an icy grave.
That lake is like a polar bear. It looks all warm and fuzzy, but look out because it'll rise up and it'll bite you.
Sergeant Jeff Bonock is the leader of the Fond du Lac County Sheriff's Department dive and rescue team. If you fall through the ice while sturgeon spearing, these guys have the guts and gear to save you.
You put a diver in the water in winter, it's very equipment intensive.
But before it comes to that, the sergeant has some advice.
You walk out onto frozen water and you need to bring some respect with you.
For the frozen chosen, the ice is both friend and foe. It is the foundation for spearing and an imperfect surface that can kill.
We're learning more about the tragedy on Lake Winnebago. It was a father and his 9-year-old daughter who died when their truck fell through a crack in the ice Saturday afternoon.
The cracks are always here every year. Some years there's two, and some years there's five. I've always said the ice is never 100% safe, and this is a perfect example.
It's basically entry at your own risk.
It's not a sport for everybody. I mean, danger definitely exists.
This is an unforgiving environment where one error in judgment could be fatal.
If it indeed is possibly safe enough for truck travel, we still go out with snowmobiles prior to the season and check the ice conditions in all areas that we might be thinking about going.
I'll take that stuff and start checking the water and the ice. All right?
On this reconnaissance mission, Stewart spots a potential death trap, steam. On the ice, steam means open water.
Well, I'm glad you turned around when you did.
Right.
Can't see it from here, but there's all kinds of steam coming up.
Okay.
I hit water big time.
I broke through and crushed the snow. If you have too much snow versus the thickness of ice, the weight of the snow will bring water up and can put a scare into you, even though the conditions may be good.
I never feel 100% safe out there. I never will.
Out here, safety is a relative term. Once ice forms on the lake, it thickens over the course of the winter, but it doesn't freeze evenly. It could be 30 inches thick in one spot and less than an inch in another.
There's big cracks in the ice. The ice is moving all the time, depending on which way the wind is blowing. There's cracks that open up and close. There's big shoves.
As cracks open and are widened by high winds, it's not uncommon to see tracks of open water.
Trucks are actually going over the cracks, over open water, from one piece of ice to the other.
There is danger in every direction. To stay alive, you must keep an eye on the ice and keep friends and family close.
As a Schumacher, we never travel alone. We never leave the lake without everybody.
This guy is living proof of the lake's unpredictability. One moment, he's driving his four-wheeler on seemingly solid ice, and the next, he's fighting for his life in the frigid water.
I was on the bottom, you know, 8.5, 9 feet of water, like nothing.
He dropped his four-wheeler through, and, you know, he certainly could have died in that situation.
Cracks disintegrate without warning. You're rolling along, and the ice gives way beneath you. In an instant, you either plunge to your death or become one of the sergeant's stories of survival.
They ended up driving their vehicle into a crack, partially submerged it, and they were stuck. They didn't know what to do. They dialed 911, and we went out there and picked them up. We went out on the ice boat, picked them up, loaded them up on that ice boat back into shore. There were two different spots we broke through.
Hey, how's it going?
Morning.
April Dombrowski out of Oshkosh. How
nice
are you?
April.
April Dombrowski is a warden for the DNR. In addition to making sure sportsmen have the proper permits, she gathers and shares all the information she can on ice conditions.
You just never know where the cracks are going to open up.
She talks to local fishermen.
This south end, there's a lot of holes. Any holes are opening up.
Listens to the local media.
Say sturgeon spears. Be very careful out there. Some reports of some not too good things happening out there with the ice.
Gets the latest aerial ice reports.
I know we use the pilot too for just kind of going up and seeing where the shoves and where the cracks are.
And monitors all frequencies.
We were pretty down yesterday. Pretty bad ice out here, I guess.
Thanks to April and others, word of the weakening ice spreads quickly. What was once a race to get on the ice to spear can become a rush hour traffic jam to escape.
I was stuck in traffic over 2 miles long waiting to get off the ice. And that's that.
Those that remain on the ice start to feel the undercurrent of danger. You want to spear a fish, but the ice is making you nervous. It's last call, and you've been served a cocktail of adrenaline and anxiety over melting ice. With sick kids at home, Chad Mookie can't wait any longer to throw his spear. Lady Luck is smiling, but she's missing her front teeth. This sturgeon isn't nearly as big as the ones he let pass.
The hole is 48 inches wide, so he's probably 50-some inches. He's not huge, but when you got sick kids at home, he's worth it.
A handshake between Chad and his dad seals the deal on another great season for the Mookies. The family's got fish on the ice. From the preparation to the execution, the Mookie family enjoys every minute of their success.
Once the fish is speared, yeah, there's a lot of partying and that sort of thing that can go on, but the reward is in the journey prior to that.
There had never been a reward in Kevin Schumacher's journey until now. His bad luck finally ended with a giant thud.
You grabbed that spear, I went boom! And I yanked on it, I said, I got it!
Well, congratulations.
Thanks.
Look at that, Kevin, that is a fatty.
Whoa. Good job.
14 seasons of frustration are vanquished in an instant by the euphoria of spearing a fish the size of a man and as old as his grandfather.
Give me a kiss. Oh, I will.
Kevin couldn't wait to get this monster to the scales. But without hesitation, Kevin recognized a larger priority.
This guy right here.
That is a nice fish.
Did you register ready?
No, that's what we're doing. Oh. We wanted,
We wanted to see, wanted you to show you first.
That's all right. That's all right.
Dad just missed that one, he said. He said it was that big around. He said it come right. Come right from his shack, too. She come right in the hole, probably about 10 feet down. I didn't even see it. Michael goes, there it is.
It's a fish story that will be told in this family for generations.
That's a dandy, right? Whoa. Got him good, too, didn't you?
Too big to carry by hand, Kevin Sturgeon rides to the weigh-in on a sled. He's greeted like a conquering hero returning from a victory at sea.
I was pretty proud when I come in, you know, it was like I was just coming down like the aisle, I mean, of something, you know, and everyone was cheering like I was in a parade or something.
Hey. Hey.
Yeah. 132. Oh.
Bigger than Grandpa's.
What you got?
132.
Hey. Oh.
Schumacher clan.
Yeah, we're the Schumacher clan.
I'm saying the biggest one I've seen so far was your grandpa's 2 years ago.
So this one beats us.
Yeah.
Everybody wants to see that big fish. And yeah, when you're successful, everybody, you know, you're king for the day. It's awesome.
78-1.
When you finally do get one, yeah, you are a rock star. You go into the registration stations or into the tavern and you draw attention immediately.
That was everybody's highlight of the day. I mean, everybody's sitting there taking pictures and everybody wanted to take pictures and...
Flush with fame, Kevin heads home with his fish and family in tow. You know how it goes with fish stories. Years from now, those that witnessed this won't remember the actual weight of the fish. Only that Kevin Schumacher speared a sturgeon so humongous, it almost didn't fit in the back of his pickup. The first official sturgeon spearing season on Lake Winnebago took place in 1932. Al Schumacher remembers it well.
When we first started sturgeon fishing, it was just the neighbors right around here. If there was 8 or 10 shanties, that would be the most. And we used to walk out.
Things have changed a bit since 32.
You look out there and you just see these thousands of shanties out on the lake. It's almost like a new community. It's another world.
The small army of Schumachers speared 10 sturgeon. Kevin could claim the clan's bragging rights with his 132-pounder, but even after waiting 14 years for a fish, he's willing to share the glory.
It's basically everyone's fish. I mean, granted, I speared it, I tagged it. I mean, everybody's happy for everybody.
Ta-da. You're right. Okay.
The proud old general looks forward to yet another battle with the beast.
I hope I live another year to get out there.
Okay. Look,
Jerry Schneider hopes to be back on the air next year. He signs off this season with one last plug for his favorite sport.
Say, folks, you know, there's nothing like sturgeon spearing, though, is there? You got to get out there and do it for yourself.
The Mookie family outworked the competition and outfoxed the fish to spear 7 sturgeon. Yet, the man that masterminded the hunt can't bring himself to celebrate. For Stuart Mookie, the last day of spearing season is the saddest day of the year.
That last day, when you close the hole, it's like closing a casket for me. And I feel that every year, and there's a certain depression that comes over me right at that moment. And it sticks for a few days. It sticks for a few days.
Thankfully, there's quite a bit to celebrate under the ice. The future of the lake sturgeon and the prospects for the frozen chosen couldn't be better.
It's the only lake in the world that has the lake sturgeon population that this one does in the world.
Not only are the numbers high, but the fish are getting bigger every year.
The record fish had a 48-inch girth, you know. That's bigger than a lot of men, and was 7 feet long.
Many, like Paul Mookie, are convinced a 300-pounder is out there.
I know that the fish exists. If it happens in my lifetime, I'll be ready for it. If it doesn't, I'm just going to enjoy the ride.
Ron Brook literally has his fingers in every aspect of the resurrection of sturgeon in Lake Winnebago and beyond. Eggs collected by Ron and his team are hatching success stories across the country. Native Americans, citizens groups, and government agencies are releasing sturgeon back into their ancestral waters.
We work with a number of agencies, some of the tribes, some of the state DNR agencies out of Georgia, Tennessee we've worked with, trying to help them get their populations reestablished and bring them, you know, back from the brink, at least in that river system that they're working in.
The relationship between the sturgeon of Lake Winnebago and men that hunt them with spears has existed for centuries. It appears the bond will continue for generations to come.
It's the kind of a species that's kind of like managing an oak forest. What you do today, you're probably not going to see the end result of, maybe in your career even.
We always want to keep the sturgeon resource viable, and we always want to keep the spearing tradition viable. And we can't have number two without number one.
We're definitely blessed to have this resource in our backyards. It may be the only place in the world to do this, so it's exciting, and I hope everybody that does sturgeon spear realizes that.
Oh, it's a great feeling. It really is. You have no idea how great that is.
I think it's always going to be deeply rooted in the people that live on the lake, and those are the people that really respect it and admire what we have here.
I had my entire family with me in a shanty that we had just cut a hole prior to the season. All these kids are off of school. And we saw 36 sturgeon in one morning go through that hole. And for those kids at that age to experience that, you get hooked.
Decades from today, this baby sturgeon and thousands like him will roam the waters of Lake Winnebago at the dawn of the next century. Above the ice, with spears in hand, the next generation of the frozen chosen will be waiting.
There's taverns all around the lake where I've actually seen it myself, where if a person gets a fish, they'll bring it right into the bar. They'll either, at a minimum, they'll lay it on the floor behind them, like it's waiting there for them to finish their drinking so they can take it home.
He was quite a drinker. He was so proud of that fish, he put it in the car and started hauling it around, showing it off, stopping at taverns. For a whole week, fish spoiled. They couldn't even eat it.
People will flop the fish directly on the bar, or they'll try to prop it up on the bar stool. And they'll pour, you know, drinks into the fish.
People like kissing their fish. I know friends who, we've got pictures of people puckered up with their lips on the fish. So I'm not into that as much. I got other things to kiss besides that. So I try to stay away from kissing fish.